And joining us this morning, we have Senator Francis Kiko Pangilinan, one of the senators who strongly opposed the abrogation of the agreement between UP and the Defense Department, and also led the filing of the resolution in institutionalizing the accord. Senator Pangilinan, good morning to you, sir.
Good morning, Karen, and sa mga nanonood at nakikinig, good morning.
All right. So you led the filing of the resolution where we know Senator Bato de la Rosa did not vote on it. But why is it important to institutionalize this accord?
Well, you know, we have to take this in the context of what has been happening in the last several years in this country. Tens of thousands have been killed in this drug war. ABS-CBN has been closed down. The anti-terror law has been passed. Thousands upon thousands have been jailed in a militarist approach to the COVID response, ineffective at that. So all this is in the context of an authoritarian, bent of this administration. Mm-mm. Kamay na bakal, the longest martial law in the history of the 1987 Constitution, mm-mm, 2.5 years of martial law in Mindanao, and what has it to show for? Really, all of this is disturbing because it is geared towards stifling dissent. It is geared towards demonizing and critics, those who speak up if they do not agree with what is happening in the country in terms of governance. And that's why we have to speak up.
Okay.
That's why we have to oppose these efforts at stifling dissent, and the abrogation of the UPDND Accord, and the threat to abrogate the PUPDND Accord, and the red tagging of other universities are all in the context of stifling this dissent, sowing fear, to serve the purpose of authoritarianism, and we reject this.
Okay. Now, Senator, you filed Senate Bill 2016, or the Academic Freedom Act of 2021. A clarification, this Academic Freedom Act of 2021 covers all state universities and colleges in the Philippines. This isn't just an amendment of the UP Charter.
That is right. This is meant, I filed actually two measures, no? An amendment to the UP Charter, and then an omnibus proposed measure that covers all campuses. To declare, actually, in effect, declare all campuses, all universities as freedom parks, which under existing law is where, you know, respect for freedom of speech, freedom of expression, is paramount and as guaranteed in our constitution.
Okay, to declare each campus as a freedom park, that's quite interesting. A freedom park, it's a very good term to coin actually for universities, a freedom park. And can you share with us details if this is made into law? Because the Academic Freedom Act will be different from essentially the amendment of the UP Charter itself, no? Tama, Senator?
That's correct.
Or the Academic Freedom Act will cover even the UP Charter?
Well, because the UP Charter is a special law.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Just to cover all bases, no? We filed a separate bill amending. My bias is because I was the principal author of the Republic Act 9500,
yes,
the UP Charter Bill. We enacted that the law was enacted in 2008, and we defended that for three Congresses, and finally had it approved. And so, I felt, being principal author, that we are to amend the UP Charter and create freedom parks and establish precisely, put in place, into law, specific provisions of the accord, then it should serve, a specific purpose for UP. And then I said, let's file a separate measure which declares all campuses nationwide as freedom parks.
Okay. Now, what are the details, for example? Just give a holistic view that covers both. The change in the UP Charter, the Academic Freedom Act, what would both cover in essence?
Well, pretty much, again, in the context of our constitutionally guaranteed rights to freedom of assembly, mm-hmm. freedom of expression, freedom of speech, we will declare campuses as freedom parks where these rights can be exercised without fear,
okay.
without threat. The context kasi of these freedom parks was, you know, during martial law, protest actions those who were protesting were arrested.
Mm-mm.
Their peaceful protests were prevented.
Mm-mm.
You know, and the military personnel would violently disperse these protest actions in campuses.
Mm-mm.
That's why the Soto and Rile Accord was put in place in 1981, yeah. which was the precursor of the UPDND Accord.
Yeah.
Because that ang daming inarest ng mga estudyante, ang daming kinulong,
Mm-mm.
pero hindi pa rin napigil yung mga pagpoprotesta.
Mm-mm.
So in exchange for, you know, peace in the campuses, nagkaroon ng negosasyon, all charges against the students then in 1981 were dismissed, mm-hmm. and the boycotts and the protest actions were also held, put aside or tinigil itong mga protesta. Pero hindi ibig sabihin na hindi na pwedeng pumotesta. For as long as it's peaceful, for as long as there is no resort to violence, that is a constitutionally guaranteed right.
Mm-mm. Okay. Now, will the Academic Freedom Act, for example, and the change in the UP Charter, because I'm going to get into detail, number one, will it require, which was the old accord, the military to first, of course, coordinate with the school management before getting into the campus? Is that correct, no?
Yes. That, and of course, there are exceptions. To notify the officials that they will, you know, enter the campus. But the exception, of course, is, you know, if it's in hot pursuit. Ang ibig sabihin ng hot pursuit ay tinutugis itong mga kriminal, pumasok sa loob ng pamantasan.
Mm-mm.
Hindi na kinakailangan sabihan ang mga opisyal. Pwede nilang tugisin at hulihin dahil nga hinahabol nila. Halimbawa, may mga bank robber dyan sa may Pilcoa, pumasok sa loob ng ano, ng UP. Hindi na kinakailangan i-notify pa ang administrasyon ng UP. Dire-diretsong pwedeng pumasok. So there are exceptions.
Yeah.
And there are also provisions, a provision that will specify that law enforcement cannot be, di ba, prevented. The exercise of law enforcement must be respected at Mm-mm. all times.
But under the Act, for example, if the military feels under suspicion, given the fact that there is also the anti-terror law in place right now with a council that may soon designate and do its own investigation on suspected terrorists, the problem of military officers milling around, being assigned, walking around in campuses, for example, for sheer presence, that would be against the Academic Freedom Act.
Yes, because precisely part of the provisions of the accord, which we would like to now make into law or enact into law, is that you cannot bring in non-uniformed. If military personnel or police would enter the campuses, they have to be in uniform.
Mm-mm.
So yung mga clandestine covert operations within the campus would be prohibited.
Okay. Senator, another controversial topic that's already been tied, no, to academic freedom as an ideal is what's happening, frankly, in UST. Are you familiar? Or you want me to give you first a background of the case of a student in UST, sir?
Yes, please.
Okay, there's a UST student wherein his family name is Ampatuan. He is, I think, grade 12, if I'm correct, or I could be corrected on this, but he's not related to the Ampatuans of the Maguindanao massacre. But he was not allowed to be readmitted in UST because he joined an organization in the school, which is Anak Bayan. So there's an Anak Bayan UST organization. And the UST handbook states, and this is where it's a bit tricky because it's a private school, students are not allowed to join unrecognized organizations as defined by the school. And the UST decision states they don't recognize Anak Bayan as an organization, and students have to sign a conforme agreeing that they would not join unrecognized organizations. So now you have the student council of UST, some members saying that the student should be readmitted under the Academic Freedom Act. Do you believe that this case would be covered under that?
We will have to look into that, no? Because this is really more specifically, no? For peaceful protest actions, for freedom of expression. But there is a constitutionally guaranteed right to association, meaning... you have to, you know, your right to associate, to join organizations, to participate in these organizations is respected by the Constitution. So, and you're also right to say that it's a bit tricky because it's a private institution that is also allowed, you know, to come up with its, you know, requirements for admission. You know? In the end, this might be a good case to bring before.
Yeah. If you have a hearing, it's also an interesting case to actually bring to the hearing.
Yes. Because freedom of association is a constitutionally guaranteed right. We have the right to join organizations. Whether or not if it's an illegal organization or an organization, has illegal, like a criminal yakuza, ibang usapan yan, di ba? Pero so it's an interesting situation that perhaps at this point, you know, the courts should look into. But yes, our proposed measure should tackle that particular right of students to be able to join organizations. Go ahead.
Okay, because there seems to be an ongoing fear with being interested in what you call or associated with left wing. Left wing automatically is assumed to be wanting to join or being recruited by the NPA. Wherein in other parts of the world, there is left wing and right wing politics, which have nothing to do with bearing arms.
Yes. Actually, it's interesting, I know. Why this penchant? Because somebody, you know, shared with me in a private thread that why are we so interested in UP when in the last 30 years, the most serious attempts at violent overthrow of government has been led by graduates of the PMA.
Not UP.
I mean, yeah, but, because of all these coup plots, no? and violent at that, and bloody at that, and really brought our economy to its knees. And I would have to say this, the UP has produced, yes, a number of those who have joined the radical left and the armed struggle, but, you know, the vast majority have been able to contribute in other fields.
No. You know?
And definitely to say that it is a haven for communist guerrillas and recruitment of NPA, I think really is a narrow, myopic, and very shallow way of looking at the University of the Philippines or the academe in general. And we really wish the extremism really is disturbing. But also the unprofessionalism. You mentioned earlier that we called out this erroneous release by the AFP, and they they have apologized, and we welcome that apology, because I know a lot of members of the armed forces who are very professional, who stick to the strictest tenets of professionalism, and this is a black eye. It is obviously not just incompetent, it is unprofessional. And the armed forces of the Philippines has invested so much in the last several decades to stick to and adhere to the strictest tenets of professionalism. This is not acceptable, and we welcome the apology. And those who were behind this, who gave the AFP and the DND an embarrassing black eye, should be punished.
Okay. There's a column John Nery wrote about what happened to Secretary Lorenzana. What was your reaction? Would Secretary Lorenzana stand on this matter? It seems that he led it, although, I mean, Malacanang says that the president just accepted it, but he wasn't part of the decision-making process. Were you quite surprised?
Well, I will withhold judgment, because he has now somehow softened up a bit and has agreed to a dialogue. So let's wait for that. No? And we also urge the AFP and the DND to also dialogue with other academic institutions, not just the UP, because over the weekend, General Parlade identified several academic institutions as havens for or being, you know, and the FEU, Ateneo, LaSalle, and UST denounced this and objected to the statements of General Parlade. So it's, you know, it's creating more tension. It's creating ano, parang lumalaki yung problema eh. Kaya para maiwasan ito at mabigyan no ng paraan na magkaroon ng pagsasaayos ng mga gusot, a dialogue with other academic institutions should also be undertaken.
Okay. Now, one solution for UP definitely is for Congress to legislate the terms of the pact. The other one, some say, is to go to the Supreme Court. You being a lawyer yourself, Attorney Teddy Te said, frankly, it's also a legal question, because in the absence of a provision regarding the pre-termination of the 1989 agreement, the two parties, some lawyers say, should be bound to perform under the mutuality principle. Can actually it be unilaterally be abrogated?
Well, that's precisely a question of legality and.
But what do you think, Senator, being a lawyer yourself?
Well, I read the letter that explained the termination and the reasons for the termination, and I feel that the reasons should have been consistent with the terms, the of the agreement. And would have cited specific grounds for the termination, but it was it was a sweeping statement without evidence, and I felt that legally, you know, the ground to terminate was not established based on the accord itself. So there is basis to bring this matter to the courts. I think in the end, let's exhaust all legal remedies to be able to resolve the dispute. But it begins with dialogue. Kung maaaring wag nandalin sa korte at napag-usapan ng maayos, this would be really a step in the right direction. And that's why the Senate yesterday approved our resolution, first welcoming the decision of the DND to go into a dialogue with UP. I'm told Secretary Lorenzana has already President Danny Concepcion. So that's welcome that in that resolution. And second is for the two parties to dialogue and revisit the accord. And we also urge the DND to reach out to other academic institutions who have made public statements and expressions of concern about the latest statements of the AFP regarding red tagging and communist recruitment in their respective institutions. So that resolution precisely approved without objection, although Senator Bato did abstain, is the sense of the Senate. And we hope this will help in the process of dialogue, healthy exchange of views, and then a resolution of this current dispute.
All right. Last word, Senator Kiko. What would you want? How would you caution the military? I mean, clearly, their actions have awakened dormant hearts of students who were busy with their online schooling, frankly, and many making ends meet, trying to survive their college year with all the new requirements of online, and suddenly they fanned the flames.
Well, we should learn from the lessons of history. Number one, students have always been, throughout history, anti-government, anti-establishment. Mm. Panahon pa ni Jose Rizal. Jose Rizal was studying in Europe. Antonio Luna, Juan Luna, they were all students in Europe when they were involved in the reform movement and the calling for changes in governance under the Spanish colonial rule. You know, and we have to have a broader view. Hindi natin pwedeng lahatin. Pero ang mga estudyante, mula pa nung for centuries, have always been in the forefront of change. They've always been catalysts for change. Mga mitsa ng pagbabago ang mga kabataan at estudyante. At dapat bigyan sila ng paraan na ilabas itong kanilang mga, sabihin na natin, mapupusok na damdamin. The more you suppress, the more they will fight, the more they will resist. And that has been the lesson in history. So I call on our leaders in the armed forces and the defense establishment, let's have a broader view. Respect the rights of students to protest, to express their dissent, to mobilize, because that is the role of students in any society in many, many years, in decades, in panahon pa ni Jose Rizal. Ganyan talaga ang mga estudyante. Kumikilos, tumataya, naninindigan, critical sa mga pangyayari. And that's precisely what is happening today. People are not happy with what's happening with the pandemic. People are hungry. People are starving. People have lost their jobs. And they want a government that will respond to these issues and not go into this closure of ABS-CBN, the passage of the anti-terror law, among others. So these concerns are affecting the students, and therefore they are expressing their opposition, their criticism, and their views, even if it's contrary to the desires or wishes of government. It should be respected.
All right. On that note, just one more. Speaking of what you said, the pandemic, given that, is this the right time? What about charter change? There are hearings already in the lower house. And I think on Wednesday, the Senate will be hearing it?
This morning at 10 o'clock.
Okay.
But before that, just one more point. And our appeal to the armed forces of the Philippines is to stick to, the strictest standards of professionalism. Let us remember that the reason why the military turned against itself in the dying days of the Marcos regime was because of unprofessionalism, favoritism. This created disenchantment in the ranks, the lack of professionalism of the armed forces. We should not repeat history. That's why professionalism in the armed forces is, non-negotiable. It has to be observed at all times. And a politicized military should also be, a thing of the past. Kaya nga dapat manatiling profesional ang ating armed forces, at alam kong marami sa ating mga sundalo, mga opisyal ng AFP at DND ay talagang mga professional yan. Dapat sila ang mangibabaw, hindi yung mga unprofessional, yung mga palpak, yung mga incompetent. Anyway, having said that,
yeah, charter change at 10 o'clock, the hearing.
Yes. There were three resolutions filed, mm-hmm. One by Senator Gordon, another by Senator Gachalian, and another by Senator Tolentino on charter change. I think yesterday another resolution was filed by Senator Lacson. So we will hear that. But first and foremost, we will be looking at procedures rather mm-hmm. than substance.
Okay.
Meaning,
do you vote today, separately?
Do we first, given COVID and the economic downturn, diba, and the upcoming 2022 elections, is it the right time to do charter change? Mm-mm. So that we'd like to ask our experts. And second, if we will do charter, will it be con us or assembly? Now, if it's con us, then whether you vote joint or separate. Of course, the other issue is in the House, they're saying it will only be economic provisions. So you have a question. If it's a constituent assembly, can you prevent members of the constituent assembly from filing proposed amendments outside of the economic provisions?
Correct.
So these are some of the issues that we would like to tackle this morning.
All right. On that note, Senator Kiko Pangilinan, thank you so much for your thoughts this morning. Thank you, sir. And good luck with your hearing. You stay safe.
Yes, thank you very much. Meron lang ako isang joke na basa ko rin sa... Sabi nila, hindi daw pwedeng pumasok yung AFP tsaka yung DND sa UP sa lahat ng UP campus kasi dapat mag-upcut muna sila para makapasok sila sa UP.
Okay, I don't know, Senator, if it's too early for that joke, but I get the joke. I get it as a UP student. Thank you, Senator Kiko Pangilinan.
Thank you.